Okay. Thank you. So we continue where we left, but before I continue, I would like to point out that I made reference to work material, and this will be put on Justad's website tomorrow. So there you will find the material, the references, and I will make several references to that material also in the second part. And this second part has a different approach than the first part, which was actually more an introduction with examples. Now I will look at different aspects of working with big data, and in the end I will broaden the scope a little bit and look at where we're heading to. I would also like to mention that you are welcome to ask questions at the end. We will have some time for that. I will take care that we have some time for that. And I should also mention there are no false questions, wrong questions or whatsoever. So just don't hesitate to ask something when I'm finished. And I am aware of the fact that you all have different backgrounds, so let's see. It's always good with a subject like this to have a good discussion afterwards. Otherwise, it's only one-sided communication, and I like to have it two-sided. So I continue with the issues and approach. So let's make a comparison between working with big data and the more traditional way with which we're working. Now, we are used, of course, to work with surveys, with questionnaires. And when you do that, you normally have a target population and you can use sampling theory. So that's clear and that's very valuable and it will remain valuable. And so this is something very basic, of course. What we also use nowadays are administrative data sources, and we are using them more and more because there's no response burden associated with them. And so it's very good to make use of administrative data sources. And many countries, and I even think the European Statistics Code of Practice stipulate that there's a preference for using administrative data sources. That is, if data is available in an administration, then don't ask it again to your citizens, to your households, to institutions, to businesses. And actually, in the way we are making statistics now, before big data, there's an interaction between using surveys and using administrative data sources. For surveys, you normally use an administrative register as a sampling frame. Not always, you can do, for instance, area sampling, but it's quite often the case that you will use an administrative register as a sampling frame. And so you need them for surveys. But nowadays, if you're really give priority to administrative data sources, then you will still need surveys to fill in the lacking areas, the gaps, and you will need to use surveys for measuring the quality of the administrative data. So they are really a couple of approaches that complement each other. And normally you can use sampling theory for making statistics. That is, however, an oversimplification, and it is important to stress this when we are using big data, because we are also using other methods than sampling theory and statistics. We use time series modeling. We use all kinds of actually econometric modeling in national accounts, because we lack some data for parts of what is covered by a national account, so you need to model them. For instance, you have to make a number of assumptions, which are actually also modeling aspects. And we're not only using sampling theory. It's interesting if you look at national accounts, where they use models as well. In national accounts, there are high quality estimates of, for instance, national product, and there is no national account estimate of the population behind these behind national accounts. That is, there's no estimation of the number of businesses that generate the business output. And that is an indication of the way national accounts work. They are not actually population-based. They are phenomenon-based, and their methods are derived from that. And so it's not only sampling theory, although we as statisticians are used to thinking in terms of sampling theory. So the question then, of course, becomes where does big data fit in? And more specifically, can we do with the methods that we've used so far in making the statistics we've made so far? And we'll see that there may be other approaches. So what are the limitations that we are faced with? And these limitations have much to do with quality. So methods and quality are very closely related, and it helps to take glasses on and look through the glasses from the viewpoint of quality. Then in a number of cases you will have different options, and then you need a policy to make choices, and that's what we will be looking at. Now, of course, there are many ways, many tools of statistics that we have already, that there are many quality frameworks also, and we should still make use of them when dealing with big data. If we can make a good estimate of a population behind big data, then by all means, let's do that. I'm not going to discuss, of course, existing methods of traditional statistics. You've had many seminars on those already, as I understand. But let's see what were the issues that we saw earlier this morning. Access to the data is a major one. Usability of the data is another. So we have the meaning of the data, like we have the question of what does sentiment actually mean. You can figure out what is the general sentiment, but what do you actually mean by that? Stability of the source is also an issue that affects the usability of the data. And that also has to do with reproducibility. But reproducibility, the question whether you can do it again, if asked for, is something different than stability. That is, if, for instance, you ask the data provider to make aggregates for you, then there's no guarantee that you can ask it in a year time to do it again, to see whether maybe when you have a question, what was behind the data. Then they say maybe, well, we don't have the data anymore, or we are not willing to do it anymore. And reproducibility is one of the things that is actually required also by the European Statistics Code of Practice. So there we have an issue. Methodological issues, we've seen the problem of selectivity and representativeness. I always make a distinction between these two, and I think it's an important distinction, because when you look at a data source, you can ask yourself, what can I do with this data source? Then you need to know the mechanism behind getting the data. What is the grid of antennas? Or what is the mechanism by which Twitter works? Do we get foreign messages or only domestic messages, and how does that work, and so on and so forth? That is a matter of selectivity. That is, what do you get? And once you know that, you can ask yourself questions, what can I do with that? And then you have the question of how can I relate this to a target population, And then you can ask whether the data, or to what extent the data, is representative for the target population. So you have first selectivity and then representativeness. Representativeness refers to something that you, a result that you have in mind already. These both things have to do with unknown populations and also with quality issues and validity, of course. Validity is something that is especially important when you're judging models. Privacy, confidentiality are clearly issues for big data, but I have added reputation because with privacy we've had the experience that in some cases we are allowed to make use of big data and we chose not to do that because we think there's a reputational risk involved, and then we are very careful. For instance, for this mobile phone data, we specifically asked for aggregate data from the provider where we gave the algorithm to them, and we asked for aggregate data and not for individual data. They may have been prepared to provide us with anonymized individual data, but we didn't ask for them, not because we couldn't get them, but not because it was not legal, but because of reputation considerations. So if anything goes wrong, then our reputation goes down, and that is very difficult to repair. So reputation is also an important consideration. And then of course there's IT infrastructure and security. We think that IT infrastructure is an issue, but it's not a showstopper. So we get more and more data, but we also get more and more possibilities to process the data. And these things tend to be solvable. The other issues can be showstoppers. Maybe you don't get access to the data, maybe the data cannot be used, maybe you cannot make what you're doing representative or get good enough quality. Privacy may be a showstopper, but IT generally is not. You can solve it. Knowledge and skills is the same. It's not a showstopper, but you have to invest in them and you need some new skills, as we'll see later. And then when you go from research to real production, you have to make a transition, and that is almost always an issue. And in our office, we tend to underestimate this, and especially when for the first time statisticians are confronted with results from big data, then they stagger, then they don't know what to do, and they start asking questions, and they see that instead of checking 200 cells of data, they have to check 5,000 cells of data, and they said, well, instead of 2 weeks in checking this, now we need half a year to check this. And so then you need another process of checking the quality. And so there's a lot involved in this transition from research to regular production. And then there are strategic challenges, which I deal with in a separate part of the presentation. And this is really something by which you can get, from which you can get a headache. And so don't lose faith. So what are actually the most important issues? This is a personal opinion, but I think that the population problems are the most important problems that we're faced with big data. Generally speaking, it depends from source to source. It differs from source to source, it depends on the source. But the population issue is probably the most important. And then an unbalanced coverage is also something that with most big data sources is an issue, and the relevance of the data. What do you actually get? What is the data? What's the meaning of the data that you hold in your hands? So there are more issues, but these are the top three. And so what you could do with the population issue, you could try at least to derive some background information. Now, in some cases, you know, you get some population information. You can get for instance, mobile phone providers, you may ask, could you give some characteristics of an analysis of your customer database? In the case of social media, it may be much more difficult, but there are also possibilities to deal with this to some extent. For instance, if you look at Twitter data, there's a name associated to the Twitter account. And for instance, from that name, you can, in most cases, you can derive whether it's male or female behind the message. And if you look at the use of language, the use of words and combination of words, then there's been social research establishing a correlation between the use of words and, for instance, age and sex. And so looking at these words, you can also get a general impression about the population behind, for instance, Twitter messages. And so there, if you are inventive, you can get quite far in some cases. Then still, if you know what is the general composition of Twitter, of tweets, the Twitter population, then you can try to compensate it in your estimation procedure, in your methodology. But still, there's of course the possibility of a bias and of missing a part of the target population. Unbalanced coverage, then normally the thing to do is to consider using models. And when there's a question of data relevance, you can try to do some calibration, that is to look at the correlation between the big data source and some benchmark statistics, and maybe even try to fit the big data in such a way that you get a very high correlation. Then of course you get a correlation, you have to study the causes of the correlation. Does the correlation have, for instance, a common cause? And then it's good to look at co-integration, look at the residuals and how they connect, whether there are patterns in those. And we did that with the sentiment indicator. And so there really seems to be a kind of a national mood that defines both the consumer confidence as we measure from our survey, as the consumer sentiment that we measure by using Twitter data. So you can get rather far. And then if you still don't trust it, then you still can ask, well, what do our customers actually want? Would they think this would still be interesting information to have, to make use of? And if that's the case, you can even use the big data source to make a statistics as a standalone. So you're not claiming that you're measuring, for instance, consumer confidence as part of your program for business cycle information, but you just say, what we did is we studied social media messages and we've got, as a result, this general mood indicator. And this moves in this and that direction through time. And it's up to the public to say whether they find it interesting or not. What we do now in the Netherlands is we make a distinction between regular statistics and professional results. And we have created 2 months ago a site for this, an innovation site, so that we now have an outlet for the professional results, so that the public does not expect the normal quality. It's a little bit like the way Google and Microsoft and other big internet players operate. They don't wait till they have a perfect product and then put it on the market. No, they start with a beta version, put it on the market, get feedback, and then improve upon that product. And so they have then a very short time to market. They get feedback for free. They improve the product and get early on a big market share for their for the product. And that's what we're trying to do. We try to get a short time to market and get out with our results very early through our innovation site. And then after some time, we make the decision, or we don't make the decision, to make a regular statistics out of it. And then already we have some experience. We have had feedback from the research community, for instance, and maybe some users. We can use that to market ourselves to government agencies, to see whether they are interested in using the data, whether they are providing funds for doing that. We position ourselves as an innovation institute, and that works works very well. So let's have a closer look at the process methodology and IT. Looking at the examples that we had, let's have a closer look at the traffic intensities. So we had to select sensors on the Dutch highways. As you remember this picture of where the sensors were in the road, you really have to make a selection. Then you have to do some pre-processing. So you have to throw away a lot of information, actually, also a lot of metadata. And you have to throw away the non-functioning sensors. You have to do something with badly functioning sensors. And then you make use of the fact that sensor data have a very high association. If you pass on one sensor, over one sensor, and a kilometer further on there's another sensor, then of course these two sensors should produce data that are closely related. And normally speaking, unless there's a way to leave the road. And so there's quite some work involved in that, because what you could also have is that there's a traffic jam, and then there's also no cars passing, vehicles passing, a sensor. Or you could have other reasons, that for instance there's work on the road going on and there's a bypass for the vehicles. And so you really have to know what's going on and to be very well aware of the of different causes. So you have to have a look at the quality, and you also need to think about quality indicators for accepting data from your sources. Once you've done the pre-processing, then there's of course the processing itself, which basically, as is the case with many big data sources, is to reduce the dimensions of the data set that you've got. And from the once you've done that, you can really start counting the vehicles and processing that information by region, by road, and then gradually from bottom-up aggregate. And then at some stage you then get the calculation to monthly traffic intensity, as we have done. And for processing you need certain IT tools. We used our Hadoop, we also use Spark, and these are tools that we have good experiences with, and these are also available on the sandbox in Ireland that I mentioned. And in the end, you have to validate the data and make ready for publication, of course. So this is what happens. At the bottom you see the aggregate and estimate action, and for making an estimate you need a frame, that's from the left, and you need a data, and the data goes from the individual sensor data through a transformation and cleaning exercise to what you use for the aggregation phase. And actually, at that stage, you are back to more traditional statistics, and then you can produce the statistical outcomes. What does that mean? That you start with a huge amount of raw data, It's about 80 terabytes for these 3 years, for 3.5 years for the real sensor data. That's really big. And so you have to throw away what you do not need. You have to look at the noise in the data. You have to look at the metadata. There's quite often a redundancy in metadata. So for instance, the metadata may be repeated at each record. And you can do much more efficiently with that. And so then you have to clean that and to make estimation, and you see the number. In the end, you have just an index that is 6 kilobytes. Also, the cleaning of the data, 500 microbytes. I could do that on my laptop if needed. But before that, the raw data and the transformed data is a different question. And so these are actually the phases that are big data specific and where you need specific infrastructure, and you have to arrange for a process that that deals with these amounts of data. So for the traffic data, we had originally a historical database of these 3.5 years, and we get access to the data through a web interface, very secure, but it's anyway data that are not confidential. And all these minute data we get. But there's another way to deal with that, not just work with a database of 3.5 years, which is the traditional way of approaching statistics. You could also use or take a data stream approach and just collect the data minute by minute. That has some obvious advantages. So, you deal with a smaller amount, but on the other hand, you have to still deal with disruptions of the data. You still have to collect them or to make an aggregate for the monthly indicator. And so it's a completely different type of process. We started this way, and we are still doing it in this way, starting with the a database approach, but we are going to a streaming approach. And in our office, the methodologists are not only concerned with statistical methodology, but also with the design of statistical processes. You cannot really separate that. And nowadays, the design of statistical process with big data also involves decisions about the IT infrastructure that you're going to use, and even the software that you're going to use, because you have to think about distributing the process for parallel processing, for instance, and the possibility and restraints in that. So you have several data options. On the validity of methods used, this is very important. This is an obstacle in many cases, because it's very difficult to really validate the data and the methods used, especially when there's models involved. And I mentioned already the use of correlation. Now, if we look at the example of using social media data, then the use of that data is clear-cut in the sense that you get a result that may have a high correlation with the data that you produce traditionally. But can you really go from the old source to the new source? Now, we think at this moment we are not quite sure that the correlation will hold in the future. We did some tests and we think it will hold, but what happens if, for instance, if there is another 9/11 event? Then will this correlation maybe suddenly break down, and then we have only a statistics based on Twitter and we don't have a survey anymore? What to do then? So it's a little bit tricky. So we think we still need our traditional survey to have as a benchmark. And so we're keeping that statistics for the time being. What we are considering is reducing the sample size, or maybe even the frequency of that statistics, And then by using a model, you can use both data sources and still, by performing certain analysis, still have benchmark information to validate the big data source. Concerning this shock, it was interesting actually that at 9/11 we already had this survey going on for the consumer confidence, and then the person in charge of that survey said, I'll stop that survey, and we didn't produce a consumer confidence index for that specific month of September. I'm very sorry that we did that, because we also, for internal purposes, we just don't have outcomes about the months of the shock. But that was the decision of the management, and I can understand that decision, because that decision was made on the assumption that it would have been very difficult to interpret the outcome of the statistics. What is consumer confidence in a month like 9/11? But then that also gives a kind of an answer to what to do with when you have big data as a source. You could do that also in that month, say, well, okay, we put a big disclaimer on what we're producing because we have had this shock. I'll say something very quickly about infrastructural needs. Actually, there's an excellent paper giving an overview, which is also in the workbook that will be put on the website tomorrow. And there's an overview of all kinds of methods, and it actually gives some assessment of those values. I mentioned already we use ourselves HPC, that is high performance clusters, and we also use our Hadoop, and we use Spark, and these we have good experiences with those. But I do know that others use other IT means, and I would not be rigid in this. I would say be open and just take what works, and but be well informed. And there's this paper which gives good information. I also give a reference in the workbook to a paper of Hal Varian, chief economist of Google, who's written also a paper on this. Of course, a little bit biased towards his employer, but still, it's a good paper. And so there's enough information to get going. And you can always go to other agencies like our agency and just ask about experiences, or have a look and try things out at the sandbox in Ireland. So this brings me to the next chapter of access and partnerships. Let's see what we have learned so far on access and partnerships. And this has been written in a report by the UNECE, and again, I had the reference in the workbook. And one of the main lessons is that you have to invest in relationship with the data provider. Even if you have a data provider that is quite willing to help, still invest in those. When we got mobile phone data, we got the data only 3 years after starting talking to them, to understand their way of thinking, to see what are their real concerns, to get some mutual trust, to get them understand what's our way of thinking, to make them understand that confidentiality is really in good hands, data is really in good hands with statistics, because it's our business, it's a condition for our own survival to handle data with care. And do start talking with them and try to get a relationship with them. Even if you do web scraping, it helps to communicate with them. And we had one example of using web scraping for house prices. And then we sent them a letter, and they said, well, actually, we are a little bit concerned about performance issues of our website, so we prefer to send you every week our database with the data you requested. So we said, okay, that's okay. So fine. And so that helps if you reach out to data providers. And then it's also good to keep in mind that there's a distinction between research and regular statistics. For regular statistics, also the legal provisions are much stricter, but still it's good just to start with research and get things going. Then you know what's involved and you know what to ask for at a later stage and what to what you really need. And that come to the another important point, that it's important not to ask more than you need. Statisticians are used to asking for data as much as they can, and then it's up to them to analyze the data and to see what they can use or not. In the era of big data, that is not a feasible approach, because you will get too much. You cannot deal with that. You really have to do some good research, to talk with the provider, and then ask what you really need. And in some cases, it may be just aggregates that you can ask for, and then you have less problems with privacy, of course. Now, statisticians tend not to pay for data, and I think with big data that will not change. NSIs and regional offices can simply not afford to pay for all records, to pay for all the data. But in some cases, we may use some private data collectors. So Statistics Netherlands makes use of a data collector for web scraping, for instance, called Data Provider. And we say, well, the information we could collect ourselves, but we pay a small amount for their effort to do that for us. Excuse me. And we do the same with the social media data. So we don't pay for the data, but for the service, for doing what we could do ourselves as well. And I should say, even with public data, there may be issues whether the purpose for which the data were produced do really include statistics. Normally it does not. So be careful with that. Look what other private companies do. If they go much further, then you may assume that it's for statistical purposes, for social interest, you can still make use of the data and take the public image into account. I mentioned that earlier. And then we are transforming ourselves to a data ecosystem, a network of data partners. That is the trend in society. We cannot do it alone anymore. We're getting being part of a network, and of course partner institutes, other NSIs, research institutes, international institutes are important partners. We cannot do it alone anymore. In our office, we have about 2,000 employees, and even with that amount, we cannot do it alone. If you look at the research budget of Google, only in research, they spend much more than our whole budget of our whole office. And so we cannot compete with them, really. This is also their core business. We cannot really compete with them on this, so we do have to form partnerships. That's really essential. So this was recognized by the UN and in the Global Working Group for Big Data and Official Statistics drafted access principles. They are still a draft because with the United Nations it takes years to get documents to the stage where they have an official status. But still, this is important enough to publish and to make use of already, because we don't have anything else. And I added this as an annex to the workbook, the access principles. And these principles cover social responsibility. That is, we claim in the access principles that for the social benefit, private institutions should businesses should provide data for free. And that is quite involving, but we still think that is feasible. They did it, for instance, with the Ebola virus problems, the mobile phone companies, for instance, Orange, made data available for making analysis for about the spread, mobility, the spread of the virus, where were the risk when you have a place where there's the virus detected, then you can look at mobile phone data to see where the people generally move to, and so you can take specific actions at those other places, at those other nodes, and so they took their social responsibility. A level playing field is important, so we have to treat businesses on an equal way so that the burden on them is more or less spread. We have to take care of competition, to be treated equally as well. So we treat businesses on equal footing and the other way around. That is, for instance, a couple, 2-3 years ago, we were dealing with Vodafone data, and then I got a phone call from German statistics office, and Peter Schmidt. And he asked me, Peter, I heard that you were dealing with Vodafone data. We're going to do that as well, or at least we are trying. We are contacting Vodafone. What were your considerations? What position did you take in the negotiations? So I told him. And that made me aware of the interest of having the same approach. We should not, as a region or a national institute, have a different approach on our own to these data providers. Because if we pay for the data of a big data source and another country does not want to do that, then that other country will just simply not get the data if we pay for the data. And so we have to have a common policy on that. And that is what is one of the objectives of this access principles. Confidentiality and security is a guarantee that we must give to the data provider. Of course, they also have to take care of this, but this is our responsibility. And so there's a strong reference from these access principles to the fundamental principles of official statistics that are the basis for actually the ethics of making official statistics at all at European, the United Nations level. There's also the ethical code of the International Statistical Institute, and within Europe we also have the Statistics Code of Practice. They all cover confidentiality and security, and this is really an important point that we have to guarantee. Transparency is also important, transparency toward the general public and also to those persons and institutions about which we hold data. We just should not make use of data and then process them into statistics without saying anything. Even if it's legal, we have to reach out and be transparent about that. And that also means that we ask our mobile phone provider to put in the contract a clause saying, be aware that this data may be used for public benefit by official statistics. Which of course nobody reads, but it still helps that you can point to that at least we are aware of it. Respect for business interest, data is money. Data is money. Many businesses nowadays base their business model on data, and we have to respect that. So we cannot just ask data that is valuable to them and make some statistics from them and then maybe reduce their value. And so we really have to talk to them and find the right balance. What is reasonable if we look at their interest and the public interest, where should we end? And that is a matter of dialogue. And when we ask data, we have to take care that we are proportional, that we do not ask more than needed, and in some cases we can do with aggregate data. With aggregate data, by the way, we have a problem that we then cannot link these data at the individual level to other data that we have already. And that used to be a big advantage for statistical institutes, combining data sources. And with big data, that may be a little bit more difficult. So these are the access principles, and it really is a matter of finding the right balance. So in the Netherlands we try to have partnerships. Now in September we started an initiative for big data. We used to work on the basis of a hierarchical organizational approach for big data, making plans and making head of units responsible for what's being done with big data. That worked to a certain extent. But now in September we started a Center for Big Data Statistics. So it's which has its own program, its own responsibility. It has a steering committee headed by the head of the statistics office above it. And it started developing partnerships. And now there are a number of partners that actually signed up formally. We have a memory of understanding with all these and many more. We have a memory of understanding, for instance, with Google. We did some research together with Google on the internet economy. And so that's really an approach that we think is very useful. It's also useful because then we can show that we are an innovative institute. Which brings me to the strategic perspective. Seeing all those issues and changes going on, we know that the context is changing in which we are dealing with data. So we also have to take a strategic view. Where do we want to be in 5 or 10 years time? And that's especially important since others outside official statistics start producing statistics as well. I know it's easy to say, well, there are quality issues involved there. They don't do it so good as we do. They can't guarantee the data. For instance, you know of Google flu trends. It's not very good in terms of quality, so let's ignore it. We are the best. Okay, that's one approach. But we have to realize that the others are still competitors because they are extremely rapid with producing data, much quicker than we are. And there is really demand for what they're producing in statistics. To give an example, we are now experimenting with social media data, as you've seen, but there are already companies that also use this public data and make also confidence general mood indicators, but they don't publish them, they sell them to companies that are active on the stock market, for instance. Because if you have information on the general mood a little bit earlier than competitors, then you can earn money on the stock market. If you can have a better forecast, better prediction of what the stocks will do in an hour's time if you just get information of the mood half an hour earlier. And so these things do have value, and in that changing context we have to find a position. And a good thing is to realize that there will still be the need for good impartial information. So maybe there are other actors. We may have from MIT this price information, I'll come back to that in a moment, for inflation. Excuse me. But even if that information there, the public needs to get a guarantee, especially the government for policy reasons, need to get a guarantee that the data are good. And so we still need to produce benchmark statistics. And that's good because that provides a basis for our existence. And the rest is all opportunity that we have to take. But we have to then to realize that we are losing our monopoly. But if we lose our monopoly, there are also other opportunities. For instance, we can then start validating information produced by others. So we are changing, we're in a changing context, and we have to take that into account. This is the Billion Prizes project of MIT, where the data from MIT is compared to the data produced by the official CPI, Consumer Price Index. And you see it is so close that you can ask yourself, should we still produce these statistics? if others also produce those kind of data? The answer is yes, because we only know that a quality is good enough by also doing this in the traditional way. And the answer is also yes, because if you look at the way MIT produces this data, they still use the data we produce on the weights for all product categories. So they only collect prices from internet, but they don't know the volume of the sales behind those prices. So we are producing that, so they're still dependent on us. But still, this is revealing. And you could also look at other countries. And then a classical example is Argentina, because there's been a couple of years where the CPI of Argentina could not be trusted anymore. It was not independent anymore. And so then actually users of statistics turned to MIT and Economist Intelligence Unit and other data producers for the inflation data of Argentina. And that was possible through big data. China is an interesting example where part of the market still goes physically through markets, so you can't measure that by big data. And so there are different situations in different countries, but it does illustrate that we are getting into a situation where people may look at alternatives to official statistics. And that is just an observation that we have to keep in mind, because that may be a threat, and we may have to react to that. Now, big data may be a hype, but in this situation, we still have to do something. And do we still want to produce everything if someone else is already producing something that is of good enough quality, or do we say, we leave that to others? Anyway, we can learn from others. So the Google flu prediction suddenly went awry, went completely wrong at some stage, and they used a model that was not sufficiently validated. It got a lot of attention. I don't blame Google so much for this. They were in the front, and because they did this and because they published everything, we could learn from them. All the research we are doing, and we are not putting so much on the internet, so we are not exposed to this. Google was exposed, and that is a good thing. But it's also a warning. It also shows that there are serious risks involved when producing data only based on big data. So let's learn from them. So what's the policy that we should pursue? We could just simply look at the issues and see what we could do. I mentioned already the investing in relations with data providers. Of course, we have to invest also in methodology. And I would also like to stress that you just have to have some people that really play with the data. Otherwise, you don't get a feeling for them. Otherwise, you do not get ideas for new data users. Don't be too strict with this. If people like to play with data, let them play with them and see what they come up. I mentioned already the use of aggregate data and the use of models. So the open mindset, that is an important thing. If we are defensive towards big data, we'll lose market position. We get less money from our own government. We are perceived in the wrong way. If we are inventive, if we take opportunities, try things out, are at the front of data science, then we can get also funds, and then government turns to us to help them with big data. And so then we take opportunities. But in order to do that, you need to have really an open mindset, and that maybe even involves a paradigm shift, a different approach to working with data. And the strategic challenges, of course, have to be taken seriously. And in the Netherlands, we took a roadmap approach. That is, we thought, let's work with just planning the new activities, so at least we ensure that we go forward. originally there was an awareness that big data is a strategic issue, so this was then discussed on the basis of a position paper for the board of directors. Since I wrote that position paper on request, I was at the moment dealing with open data. That was how I came into big data, and then afterwards they followed up, and so we wrote a roadmap for big data. But writing a roadmap when you are more or less the first doing that, it's a little bit tricky, or doing it in the right way. So we asked IBM to validate it, and they said, well, it's the right approach, and they gave a couple of suggestions for improvement. And that helps. If you do something and you do something new, do reach out to get comments. And in this case, it was just a paid assignment to IBM. The reference is also given in the workbook. And this roadmap is, of course, something that has to be updated once in a while. And it has to be monitored. And someone has to be responsible at the highest level. So it's our Deputy Director General. So this is the approach we took. Once you implement it, you have also to deal with practical things. So we also had a coordination group for big data. And a roadmap approach has a certain scope. And we took as a scope that we put into the roadmap all outputs that we intended to produce with big data and define the timeline for that. And we also identified the ownership of these statistics, so we have a point to make responsible, to ask, hey, how far are you? And then they say, well, I can only guarantee that I'll produce this, this statistics based on big data if this and that condition are met. And so we said in the roadmap, we have to make also the conditions part of the planning, so that, for instance, there's a guarantee that there's enough IT infrastructure, that if asked for within a couple of weeks, there's an advice on data security or privacy issues. So we put that part in the part of the roadmap, and then everyone could give their commitment. And we also have two supporting programs. One is an innovation program, and one is a methodological research program. The methodological research program is a little bit more fundamental. You never know whether the results can be used or not in statistics. For instance, we looked at Google Trends, and then we found out that a certain Google trend, if you try to calculate it after a year, then it may give a different figure, because they change the algorithm. Google changes the algorithms through time, and this algorithm is not public. So then it becomes a very difficult source to use for official statistics. But that was a negative result of methodological research. An innovation program is when you have good methodological research and you want to implement it, then you make proof of concepts, then you know that it's in principle feasible, you are just finding out what's the best way to implement it. So these two programs we have in place. Now, the roadmap itself has a number of subjects, and we identify new types of data or improved timeliness of data and efficiency of data, the zero footprint. And this actually, we started with the roadmap, and then in September we started our Center of Big Data Statistics, and now the roadmap has been taken over by this center. So now even the governance of big data is now changing, and this is actually a product that I show now. It's actually a draft, but since it's rolling, it will always remain a draft of what we are doing, and it gives some impression. I'm not going through this for time reasons. What we also have to take care of is that we need data scientists. We just don't need simple statisticians. We need nerds, data scientists. We need people that have it in their fingers to work with data, to do some analysis, and who like to do that. That's actually essential, that they have an open mind. And so these data scientists are needed. We also have some program for for training our own people. So we have a master class of big data, and we also have a 1 week big data training course together with a university in our country. So they send PhD students and we send statisticians to look at to work with data in practice and to see what are the possibilities. And together with ISTAT, the Italian Statistical Bureau, we give the European course on big data, ESTP course. So I mentioned already, open minds are needed. And we also try to position ourselves as an innovator in order not to get into a negative spiral that we get less and less money. And finally, we are out of business, or almost out of business. We try to be the center of data in the Netherlands and then climb up and grow a little bit and get better and better and get the help of others to get better by being part of many partnerships. And so Statistics Netherlands has a tradition as an innovator. We have, of course, Jan Timbergen, who was a Nobel laureate and who also worked at Statistics Netherlands and then developed or provided the basis for national accounts at world level. We have questionnaires. We're using developed Blaise, and I think you're also using that. I think we have now new ways of data collection. We were also an early adopter of an enterprise architecture, so to get rid of all the stovepipes of different statistics, but to have them in one framework, so that it makes easier to guarantee quality, to combine different data sources in your process, and also to plan for the wider future. Visualization is very important. I gave already some illustration. And now big data, we're trying to stay in the vanguard. And I think there's some parallel with Eustat. I think Eustat is an organization that has kind of a similar spirit. And it's, of course, much smaller. And so in a way, it's much more difficult. But the fact that we are here together now is an illustration of the mindset of Eustat, and I have a lot of appreciation for that. And that's also a reason for me to come here and to accept the invitation. So the last part, before we go to the questions, is I quickly go through a couple of examples. And these examples, again, show the possibilities, the opportunities with which I started. And actually, with the examples we've seen, I've covered all opportunities already, because with some new statistics, you can take advantage of many possibilities. You can reduce the response burden, make it cheaper, at the same time be quicker, and for instance, and so then you have covered already three of these seven opportunities with only one statistics. And I'll give a couple of other examples. For instance, social media you could also use to make statistics, making use of accepted social theory, where there are six basic emotions. And you could just simply look at these separate emotions and look how they look like. So we did some research on that, and the different emotions through time are seen here. Normally, where you see a pattern from once in a year, that has to do with New Year, where there are special emotions associated with Christmas and New Year. Optimism, for instance, and a lot of best year wishes, those kind of things. And so let's look at just one of them, the dimension of sadness. And if you follow that through time, then you see some peaks, and they have to do with special events, special occurrences. So for instance, somewhere to the right, you see that there was a plane crash in Ukraine, And it happened to be a plane with lots of Dutch people involved. Actually, I myself had once taken that plane, so I had luck. And so then the mood of the whole nation goes down. And it's important to keep an eye on that when you're using these type of data sources. Credit card data. I promise you to give up an example. This is from Bureau of Economic Analysis of the US. And so it's a kind of a mirror to the retail trade data that they're regularly collecting. And this comes very close. And that's very promising. And so they don't have this as a regular source. They only got few data for the analysis purposes. But this also shows the potential of this of financial transaction data. Satellite data is used in Australia, although this is not made made by them. Land use and crops is an obvious application. And satellite data can also give some data on the economy, because you can, for instance, follow to what extent oil tanks at ports are filled, and you can look at how many cars are standing at in ports or other places, railway stations, waiting to be distributed to dealers. And that changes through time, and if you consider that, you can make interesting statistics and maybe be a little bit ahead of the business cycle if you look at that. You could also think of combining different sources, not only big data sources with all the other sources, but also different big data sources among themselves. Since we did research on phone data and on sensor data, we obviously had an opportunity to link them, and so we had a look, and then you see similar patterns. You can make use of that also for quality control. Traffic intensity is also associated to GDP, and we got this data from a data camp that we had with the university. So these were the students that came together 1 week and looked at the data, and we asked them, just open, you're going to be data scientists, these are the data, so what interesting information can you get out? So some got with one subject, some with other subjects, and one of them came up with a correlation between traffic intensity and GDP. It's not a very it's not a perfect correlation, but still, for business cycle purposes, given that the value of the data depends on how quick you are, this is still very valuable as knowing such a correlation, and you can then also even use it as a standalone. Now, this is something that shows another application where we use modeling. We have a number of environmental statistics in the Netherlands, and we make use of data gathered by volunteers. That is, there are many people who have as a hobby to look at plants and animals, and they report, and we don't control the network. We don't control who will report on the observation of animals or plants at what time. But we do get the observations. And so we looked at the observation that the anemone, a kind of a plant, flowered. And we just put all the data of where there was any flowering anemone reported. We put it on the map, and then we connected all the points that making use also of weather information of that time. And so what we did for 2 years, we made this this graph. So you see in 2014, this started flowering earlier, and it started from another part of the country. And this is with data that is not representative, that is not well structured, that is completely out of our control, but still the information is there, and we can make use of it by just modeling it in a good way using our common sense. And then we still have a quite reliable picture of when this plant, in this case, started flowering in the country. So there are many possibilities that you may never have thought of, and that become possible with big data. So I'm coming to conclusions. I mentioned already getting to know big data and using it for different purposes. You really have to make work of that. For time reasons, I go quickly through this, and because it's some repetition, but I would like to stress again that creating the right environment is really a key issue. And another key issue is that you form partnerships. And this is a frog. And why is there a frog on this sheet, on this slide? That is because frogs seem to have a certain characteristic. If you take a frog and you take a can of hot water and you throw the frog in the hot water, what does the frog? It jumps out of the water. What does happen if you put a frog in cold water and you heat the water gradually? Then the frog never jumps out, but it gets cooked. And we have to be careful not to get into the situation of the frog. And that is actually my message of today. And so I do think that big data is a game changer. I think the future is to big data, although it is a hype, it is still something like internet itself that remained there and remained important. And so I think it will be time for discussion now with you. I hope there will be questions from your side. I'd like to thank you for your attention. Muchas gracias. Eskerrik asko. And a special thanks to the translation, which I know is a very difficult job, and thank you very much for doing that job. Oh. I will now sit down so I can hear what you ask if it's not in English. So are there any questions? Who dares to ask a question?
Hola, buenos días. ¿Qué tipos de datos se obtienen de las redes sociales de Facebook, de Twitter? ¿Son palabras clave? ¿Son cantidad de datos? ¿Qué es lo que más influye en las estadísticas que están obteniendo de ahí?
Thank you for this very relevant question. So what we get is the messages themselves. So we could do analysis on the raw data. We only get messages that are public, and we only get messages that are in the Dutch language. That is, the company that provides these data is Cousteau, and they also collect data in the English language. And actually, the analysis we did with the Dutch language, we also did with the English language, and we got similar results. Interestingly, we have this consumer confidence data, and we compared it with the social media data. And when we did the same in the United Kingdom, we found out that actually there were some quality issues with the consumer confidence survey that they did. and that had to do with their sample size, which was not that that big. And so I don't want to be this on record, but that was an interesting finding. So then you use big data to use to evaluate the quality of your regular statistics rather than the other way around. The data we get from Cousteau consists not only of the messages themselves, but also of a sentiment value. And the mechanism behind that is that each message is evaluated by Cousteau, and it gets either the value positive, neutral, or negative. And then what we do is we just add up all the positives, all the negatives, and then see what is the balance. And that provides the index. And that is exactly the way we work with the Consumer Confidence Index, which also asks people whether they have a positive or a negative or a neutral feeling about the state of the economy. Actually, there are 5 questions. There's also a question on whether they feel inclined to make big purchases within 1 year. But still, this idea of having a balanced sentiment is the same with these two, and it makes that methodology also somewhat comparable. What we also did was looking at making use of only a subset of the social media messages. That is, we looked at whether taking out some of the tweets would improve the correlation. And what we found out, that the best selection of Twitter and Facebook data that we could use would be all messages that makes use of at least one of the 7 most used words in the Dutch language. And what does that say? There are messages which just does not use any normal words. And if you throw those away and you still use the sentiment of the remainder, then you get a higher correlation, and so the data will be more useful. What we did not do is look at the messages themselves and derived our own sentiment from the raw data, because that would have been quite an effort. There are many universities involved in it, and we just followed Cousteau in this, just because we wanted to see whether those data already yielded a result that is usable for statistical purposes. I hope that answers your question. Any other questions?
Thank you, Mr. Sturgis, for your excellent presentation. My question is regarding the legal matters. You mentioned that you are, I think, trying to adapt your legal framework so that it enables you to access data from, I suppose, big companies, big corporations. I think Canada is doing the same thing. And from your point of view and your position in the ESS, don't you think that we should have a European regulation, kind of a directive or something like that, that not only give us that framework, but will also be the same for every country, and these big companies will be maybe easier for them to know how to handle this situation?
At the level of the European Union, at Eurostat, and also at in other organizations. And this is something that is not suitable for having a European law in the sense of a directive. That is, a directive has right away legal force in member states, but another possibility is to use a directive which obliges countries to change their law in such a way that you have the same result. And at the moment, at European level, the e-privacy directive is being reconsidered. There was a public consultation. I myself put some input to that public consultation. I had contact with other countries. I tuned my response to other countries. And what appeared was that the legal situation in countries is completely different in their approach to privacy and confidentiality issues. So if we do something like this, we should use the tool of a directive and not of a regulation. And but then there still is the basic question: do we want to prescribe this at a higher level? I think the climate is not prepared for that. Also, I think if you have legal provisions for getting access, then you need to be sure that you take the right course. And this area of big data is changing so much, it's so much in flux, that it would not be wise now to codify this in European law. But at the national level, that is different. So in the Netherlands, we had this roadmap approach. By the way, Italy also has such a roadmap. We had this roadmap approach, and so we had a number of statistics that we wanted to make based on big data. And one of them was regular statistics based on mobile phone data, and another was regular statistics based on financial transaction data. And we had been talking with providers for years, and we had a feeling that we did not really move. So in that sense, in the Dutch situation, we said, well, working with partnership, okay, but in this case, and they actually encouraged us, let's go to the legal track. And in our system, we have, of course, confidentiality legislation in place. We respect that, of course, that goes without saying. But we also have statistics law, and we have within the statistics law a clause about data access. And this is data access to traditional sources, and it does not cover big data sources. So what we are now trying, but this will take at least 3 years, in my opinion, to realize it. What we are trying now is to change that provision about data access, and then at least for these two specific data sources. But in other countries, it's really a national judgment whether or not to follow this. Actually, I talked to the Irish on this, and they thought that they were in a privileged position because their statistics law made it possible, or they thought would make it possible, to make use of many big data sources already, because their statistics law was formulated in a rather broad way. And then when they really wanted to start doing that, they got a warning from their data protection agency saying, wait, we also have an interpretation of the law, and that is quite different from yours. So be aware of what you're going to do with that. And so then they stopped doing that. And so that is a different situation from country to country, also in the logical structure of legislation. And then, of course, countries that have a federal structure are, again, in a different situation from countries that are more horizontally organized, like the Netherlands, which is, after all, a small country. Germany, for instance, has an approach to data where everything that is being collected has to be stipulated in advance and has needs a legal basis. In our case, we have a statistics law that is a little bit broader, so it is a specific decision made by a minister and the statistical council that fills in the details of what can be collected. Thank you. The gentleman at the back. I'm sorry, but it's healthy.
Thank you very much for your talk. That was very interesting. And you said we definitely need a data scientist in the world, in Europe. And I would like to know your opinion about the type of training we should provide. And I come from the university, and do you think the university should develop some bachelor's or master's or something like that for data scientists, or going on with training mathematicians, statisticians, computer scientists, and then giving them some complementary training or something?
Thank you. I think many institutes are asking the same question right now. The first question is, what skills do we need? And we need actually the combination of skills that we find in traditional statisticians, good statistical skills, mathematics skills, skills of analysis, but together with skills on ITs and on software tools, and maybe skills with a little wider perspective, feeling a sense of what you can do and are allowed allowed to do. And there's also an aspect of mentality that is needed. You really need people that are open for to new approaches. And we have in our office some people that are highly respected and that I respect personally very highly, that have a very good reputation within the area of sampling theory. But once you talk with some of them about big data, then they become right away quite defensive. And so in terms of personal skills, they are not yet, that may change from person to person, not yet adapted to being good data scientists. And so we do think that is part of the question of what is needed. Now, there's another question associated with that. Do we need all those skills within one person, or do we need those skills at a team level? Then I think the team level is more important, but these people in the team must understand each other and can talk to each other, and so there's they still need some basic knowledge of each other's competences. And this is about the skills. Then there's the question of how to get these data scientists. What you see appear nowadays, there are many universities having a data science center. The UK has started something like that in Newport. Actually, they formally start, I think, in January. And they do that together with the ONS. And that was the result of an evaluation by the Commission of Bean, which evaluated the statistical system of the ONS, the National Statistical Institute of the UK. And this Commission Bean concluded that big steps had to be taken for the Institute to adapt themselves to start using big data. And one of the things was that they need to take much more attention to developing data scientists. And so now they have this partnership with university, this big data, or this data science center together with them. And you see also at universities that everywhere these data science education courses pop up. And we have to make use of them. And at the same time, we cannot rely completely on them because there is much competition. Nowadays, all organizations, especially private enterprises, ask for data scientists. So be aware that there may be a shortage for data scientists, even if there's enough education capacity. We may still find it difficult to get data scientists. And that, by the way, is an important reason also to have a good profile as an institute, because we cannot compete with Google for good data scientists, but we can still, in terms of salary. But still, we know that we have data scientists in our office that say, well, we feel concerned with the public cause. and we don't care so much about salary. And we actually find it very important that we really have a working environment where we can try things out and get some freedom of doing things. And those are the people that, for a public service, also work day and night. And so there are possibilities. You don't have to fix on salary. We really can get good scientists. But then you need to be aware of your image and really try to position yourself as an innovation institute. Nowadays, we have a few data scientists from which we just contracted. We have internal courses so that those which have it in themselves, our own staff, to become good data scientists, we try to train them. And we also, that's the third category, we have students from universities. And by the way, we already had a network, also before big data, of professors working at universities and from Statistics Netherlands. So we pay them, and so that's a kind of network that we had already, and that now pays off in the field of big data. Does that answer your question? Okay, thank you. Are there any other questions? Actually, Spain, I think, yes, there will be a possibility for one more question. Actually, Spain is famous for working late till lunch, and whereas in the Netherlands we stop at 12, and so that's an interesting difference. But I like actually the Spanish culture in the Iberic culture, the Southern culture, more than the Northern culture in that sense. So if there are still questions that take away some time from your lunchtime, I would not mind. So please.
Hi, my name is Robert Ratic. I have some question about social responsibility. What's going on if you want, what's going on about someone who wants to start his business with a small company with any support about social responsibility, about social responsibility?
I'm not quite sure that I understood your question. When we look at big data sources, we normally don't look at small companies, but at big companies, because they are the most interesting sources. There's also a matter of helping other companies with big data, and then we have to respect the fact that we don't want to distort competition. And so, of course, when we have a partnership with a business, then we need to provide something in for them, so that it is also interesting for them to cooperate with us. For instance, we help them in understanding their own data, but we don't go much further. But I'm not sure that I answered your question in this way. It's maybe also a matter of hearing it clearly.
Sorry, if you want, I repeat again.
Please.
Yeah, you're talking about the... One moment. About the social responsibility. If you want to start some small company, what's going on about the someone want to start his business with a small company with any support with the social responsibility?
So I think for small businesses, these are not covered by this notion of social responsibility. Of course, they have social responsibility, but there are no consequences on the field of big data. I mentioned social responsibility at the beginning of what I said with access principles. And this, the first access principle is about the social responsibility of companies to provide data for the public good, for free. And it also says it's on a voluntary basis because it's United Nations level. There's no legislative power. It's just a kind of principle that if we all use that, that would work out very well both for companies and for public statistics, for official statistics. But actually, small businesses are not really concerned with this. With small businesses, of course, there are small businesses that work with big data. Actually, startups sometimes do work with big data, and it's also quite often the policy of governments to promote this. But then they are rather collecting them than being right away a big provider of big data. And also for some big data, there may be alternative sources. For instance, for web scraping, there may be alternatives to get the data. And so you could do web scraping yourself, or you could go to a company that also does web scraping, and you can get the data from them, as we also do. So there, I think, the association between small businesses and social responsibility in the field of big data is not that close right away. Okay, thank you. If you have more questions, we can also bilaterally discuss this further at lunchtime.
Thank you, Peter. Gogoratu dan hori, mintegia orain amaitzen da eta arratsaldeko 3:00 jarrituko dau. Recordaros a todos que termina ahora y continuamos a las 3:00. Gracias. Eskerrik asko.